friends, welcome to my channel Dental Edge. I am Dr. Bhanu Chugh. Today I will be talking about Mucocele. Mucocele, it's an important topic since it's asked to write in examination. The slide is kept for identification in practical exam, as well as there are multiple Viva, MCQ or fill up the blanks from the same. So do watch the video till the end. Also, if you are new to my channel and you want to learn dental topics in a very simplified manner, do subscribe to my channel and click the bell icon so you don't miss anything. Now, let's get started with today's topic. Now, Mucocele, it's a common lesion of the oral mucosa and it's a clinical term. Based on the location of the lesion, the way the lesion appears, how it is on palpation, then the age of the patient, the history given by the patient. But histopathologically, that is once the lesion is submitted for biopsy and once we see the slide, it is of two types. It is either a mucous extravasation cyst, which is very common, or a mucous retention cyst, which is much less common. Now let's see what is a mucous extravasation cyst. A mucous extravasation cyst occurs when there is a break in the salivary gland duct. So the saliva, instead of going into the oral cavity from the duct, it pools off in the connective tissue. Due to this pooling of the saliva, there is an inflammatory reaction of the body and a granulation tissue is formed around the pooled saliva, and this leads to formation of the mucous extravasation cyst. As you can see on the screen, normally a saliva, it will go into the oral cavity, but due to the break in the salivary gland duct, the mucus, it pools in this area, and this around this area there is formation of a granulation tissue. This leads to formation of a mucous extravasation cyst. If you can appreciate in this image, this is a mucocele on the lower lip. Due to the pooling of this mucin, the epithelium, it is stretched and it is slightly elevated, which leads to formation of the swelling. Now, a very important thing is that it is not a true cyst. A mucous extravasation cyst is not a true cyst. Why? Because if you've seen my previous lectures, a cyst, it is a pathological cavity consisting of fluid, semi-fluid or gaseous substances, and which is lined by epithelium. Now, in the case of a mucous extravasation cyst, there is no epithelial lining. There is only a mucin pool and there is an inflammatory reaction due to which a granulation tissue is formed around it. Therefore, it is not a true cyst and it's a pseudocyst. Now, this can be a Viva question. Give an example of a pseudocyst or a false cyst. So, it's a mucous extravasation cyst. And why it is so? Because there is no epithelial lining. Also, this mucous extravasation cyst, it mainly affects the minor salivary glands and that too of the lower lip. Lower lip is the most common site. Coming to the clinical features, as I told you, lower lip, as a result of injury or biting of mucosa, it is a common site. Then the other sites are buccal mucosa, floor of mouth, ventral tongue, soft palate and retromolar area. Upper lip is a very uncommon site, and if you see a lesion on the upper lip, then you should suspect a salivary gland tumor rather than a mucocele. Coming to the age of the patient, as I told you, usually it is due to some trauma, although the patient will not recall a history of trauma. Since it is due to trauma, it is more commonly seen in children and young adults. Coming to the sex predilection, it is equally common in both male and females. Usually a mucocele is superficial, and therefore, because there is mucin pooling in the connective tissue, so it will appear translucent blue in color. Sometimes the mucocele is deep, and in such case, the color of the lesion is of normal mucosa. Size is from a few mm to centimeter, rarely it exceeds 1 cm in size. And appearance, it has a dome-shaped appearance, that is semicircular appearance is there. Then it is fluctuant, movable, and as I told you, it bluish translucent hue is there. Duration is variable. Now, one of the characteristic finding is that the patient may tell you that there is a recurrent swelling. For example, a swelling is there, it may burst and the fluid, it may escape into the oral cavity. It may lead to an ulcer that may heal, and again, due to the severe duct, the mucin will pool in it and again a swelling will be there. So the patient may complain that he has recurrent swelling on that particular location. There's a variant of mucocele which is called as a superficial mucocele. These are small vesicles, 1 to 4 mm in size, usually seen on uncommon sites like soft palate, retromolar area, posterior buccal mucosa. They burst, leading to painful ulcers, and this can be confused with a vesicular bullous lesion. Coming to the histopathological features of mucous extravasation cyst, as I told you, there is a break in the salivary gland duct and the mucin it pools in the connective tissue. Due to this mucin pool, there is a reaction. There is formation of a granulation tissue. A granulation tissue is a tissue that is richly vascular, has inflammatory cells, fibroblasts, young collagen fibers. So this is what will appear on the slide. Below the epithelium, there will be a mucin pool. This is the mucin pool. Then this is surrounded by granulation tissue. And sometimes you can also see presence of feeder duct. That is, the severe duct will also be visible in the slide. You may be asked in exam, what is a feeder duct? That is the severe duct, is the feeder duct for the mucocele. Now, one very important question in this is, what are mucinophages? And this can be a Viva question or an MCQ or fill up the blank question. As we know, there is an inflammatory reaction. So the macrophages, they infiltrate into the mucin pool. They phagocyte mucin and become vacuolated or foamy. And these are called as mucinophages. As you can see in this image, this is the mucin pool and this is the granulation tissue surrounding the mucin pool. Again, these are the mucinophages, cells showing foamy or vacuolated cytoplasm. So what all we have seen? Mucin pool surrounded by granulation tissue, presence of mucinophages. Then sometimes there can be presence of ruptured duct, that is feeder duct may also be visible, and the adjacent salivary gland tissue, it may show some changes like chronic inflammatory cell infiltrate, dilatation of the ducts. One very important point is, there is no epithelial lining, right? That's why it's a pseudocyst. There's only a granulation tissue, and long standing lesions, this may turn into a compressed connective tissue wall. Coming to the treatment of mucous extravasation cyst, short-lived lesions, they rupture and heal themselves. Long-standing lesions, they are surgically excised. Always the surgeon should excise the adjacent salivary gland tissue so that the feeder duct is not left behind. Because if the feeder duct is left behind, it will lead to recurrence of the mucous extravasation cyst. The prognosis is excellent except if the feeding duct is left behind. Coming to the less common type, that is the mucus retention cyst. Now, the mucus retention cyst was formed due to obstruction of the salivary gland duct. This obstruction can be either due to salivary calculus, stone or xylolith. Then sometimes it can be due to periductal scarring or some impinging tumor. Now, due to this obstruction, the mucin, it will pool in the duct and it will lead to dilatation of the duct. So there is a cavity that is filled with mucin and that is surrounded by the ductal, compressed ductal epithelium. Therefore, a mucus retention cyst, it's a true cyst. So if you can see in this image, this is the obstruction and the saliva that will be produced, it will get obstructed. So there will be mucin pool here and this will be lined by the ductal epithelium. Now, clinically, it is difficult to differentiate between a mucous extravasation cyst and a mucus retention cyst. It usually affects adults and it can affect both major and minor salivary glands. In the oral cavity, the common sites are, it usually involves the minor salivary glands of the floor of the mouth, buccal mucosa and lips. And sometimes the patient may complain of pain, especially during mealtime, because during mealtime the saliva will be produced and due to the blockage, the saliva will not be able to escape and it will lead to back pressure and the patient may complain of pain during mealtime. Coming to the histopathological features of a mucus retention cyst, now in this case, since there is mucus pooling within the duct in the slide, there will be presence of a pathological cavity that will be filled with mucin and surrounding it will be ductal epithelium. This ductal epithelium, it can be either cuboidal, columnar, or it can be atrophic squamous epithelium. Sometimes the epithelium, it may undergo oncocytic metaplasia appearing as papillary folds into the cystic lumen. Now, if you can see in this image, and this is the connective tissue, and within the connective tissue, there will be a mucin pool, and this mucin pool is surrounded by the epithelial lining. Coming to the treatment of mucus retention cysts, surgical excision along with the adjacent minor salivary gland tissue. Now, let's see what's a ranula. Sometimes you can be asked what is a ranula, and especially in viva, you can be asked what's a ranula. So, a ranula, it is a swelling in the floor of the mouth. Now, usually it's a mucous extravasation cyst in the floor of the mouth. Now, remember that a ranula, it usually involves the sublingual gland. Sometimes it may also involve the submandibular gland or other minor salivary glands of the floor of the mouth. And why is it called a ranula? This is the reason. The word rana, it means a frog. And as you can appreciate from the image, this swelling, it resembles a frog's belly. Therefore, it is called as a ranula. The ranula, it is present lateral to the midline. It is a dome-shaped, painless, slow-growing, soft-movable mass, translucent, blue in color, and it is, as I told you, located in the floor of the mouth, and it is present lateral to the midline, and it is usually translucent blue in color. If it is present deeper, then it is of the color of normal mucosa. Now, usually a ranula, it's larger than the other mucocele in the oral cavity. It may grow to large size, filling the floor of the mouth and leading to elevation of the tongue. You can be sometimes asked what is a plunging or cervical ranula. Now, it's a rare suprahiatal type of ranula in which the mucin, it crosses the sublingual space through the myelohyoid muscle and enters into the submandibular space, and it leads to a swelling in the neck. So, it is called as a cervical or a plunging ranula. Histopathologically, as it is a type of mucocele, it will show histopathological features of a mucocele. The treatment is either marsupialization, which is not very successful, or more commonly, there is excision of the sublingual gland or the associated gland. It may recur if the gland is not removed properly or the associated gland is not removed properly. So friends, we are done with mucocele. So to just summarize, mucocele, it is a common lesion of the oral mucosa, and it's a clinical term, which is histopathologically of two types, mucus extravasation cyst or phenomenon, which is very common, or less commonly a mucus retention cyst. Mucus extravasation cyst, it is a pseudocyst, and mucus retention cyst, it is a true cyst. Mucus extravasation cyst, in this, there is a break in the duct and the mucin, it pools in the connective tissue. And this mucin pool is surrounded by granulation tissue. In case of mucus retention cyst, there is an obstruction in the duct and there is mucin pooling within the ductal tissue, leading to dilatation of the duct. Ranula, it is a type of mucocele. So friends, we are done with the topic. If there are any suggestion or feedback, do let me know in the comment box. Also, it takes lots of effort to make such videos. Your one like can give me lots of encouragement. So do like my video, subscribe to my channel, and keep watching. Thank you.